Hey everybody, what's up? It's MPC for YouTube, bringing you the ultimate guide for the game, The Incredible Adventures of Van Helsing. The table of contents for this guide can be found in the description below the video, so please enjoy the guide.
So many people do be cool and look smarter.
Don't hold back.
And you shouldn't even care about those noses in the air and the crooked stairs.
Don't hold back.
Cause there's a party over here, so you might as well be here with the people care.
Don't hold back.
The world,
you're holding back.
The time has come to. The world,
you're holding back.
The time has come to.
Hey, this is MPC for YouTube, and thank you for taking the time to look at my ultimate guide to the incredible adventures of Van Helsing. Before I begin, I just want to give you a quick introduction about who I am, why I made this guide, and what to expect from it. To start, I'm the world's best Van Helsing player. I've sunk over 2,000 plus hours into this game, and I was the first person to get every achievement you could get at the time the game was originally released. This includes the Carnage Incarnate achievement, which is kill 500,000 monsters. I was also the first person to complete Neverending Story on Heroic, and I've helped over 1,000 people with this game. Now, as to why I made this guide, the developers of this game have left out so much information which is not right to its consumer base, because when you purchase something, you have a right to know everything that's in it. And since the developers withheld this information, the game really can't be played right. Which brings me to the point on what to expect from this guide. While a lot of other guides out there only focus on single aspects such as a specific character build or, you know, certain secrets and little tips and tactics here and there, what my guide does is I actually teach you how the game works and how things interact with it. That way you can actually apply that information to no matter what you're doing in the game and actually have an effective build. So, without further ado, let's get into the guide. One of the most frequent questions people ask me is what difficulty should they make their character on? And the answer is Heroic. In order to understand why I said Heroic, I'll explain the difference between the difficulty levels. Contrary to what people think or what they know or what they've read, there are actually only two differences between a harder difficulty. One, the monsters become harder to beat on a harder difficulty. And two, most important, is the items, the equipment you get. I see so many people playing on casual, normal, and hard, and then they wonder why they're not getting items. So, in order for me to explain this, I'm going to break it down really simple so you can get a full understanding on how the different difficulties work when it comes to items. Now, I am going to be very clear about something. What I'm going to explain is not how the item drops work in this game. All I'm doing is using this as an example to get you to understand how the items would work in the game for drops. So again, I clarify, this is not how the item drops work. This is just a simple explanation to get you to understand why playing on Heroic is better than playing on the other play modes. Okay, so starting with casual, let's say one epic item falls or drops off a monster or out of a chest or wherever, one out of every 500 drops. People think putting on more magic find is going to give them more epic drops in that 500 item drop rate, and that is totally untrue. The item drop will always remain at 1 on casual. In order to get multiple epic drops, you actually have to play on a higher difficulty. So again, this is an example. This is not how this works. Using normal, we'll say that 2 epics fall out of every 500 drops. On hard, 3 epic items drop out of every 500 drops. And on heroic, we'll say 4 epic items drop out of every 500 drops. Now, when people put on magic find, again, going back to casual, they think if they load up with magic find, that you will get two item drop. They will basically turn the epic drop ratio from normal onto casual, and that's not going to happen. However, the reason that you don't need those epics on those play modes is because the play mode is actually easier, and the game won't have to give you those items in order for you to be able to play. On heroic, you actually need those items to be able to go further, and that is why you get more drops on heroic, and that is why there is really no reason to not play on heroic, as difficult as it may be. You're just jipping yourself out of items if you don't play on heroic, and that is the reason why. Now I'm just going to quickly go over some of the keybinds with you, because you either may not know about them, or you may know about them but not understand how they work. Now I'll be using the default key bindings when explaining this, and the first key I'm going to go over with you is G. G will actually allow you to pick things up off of the ground, so you don't have to click on each individual item in order to pick it up. So here I am going to run around pressing G. The next keys I'm going to talk to you about is the arrow keys. Whether you realize it or not, you can actually move your character around with the arrow keys. Here I am moving around with the arrow keys. The next key I'm going to talk to you about is Tab. Tab is really good because it allows you to swap between specific skills that you have set up in the left or right mouse buttons, whether you're using ranged or melee. So in this case, watch, I'll be using Strike and Strike, and then I'll press Tab, and you'll see that I can actually have Lightning Strike and Embracing Flames, and then Strike. The next keys I'm going to talk to you about, which really are not clear, are the F keys. Because if you go into the Options menu, you'll see the F keys, but exactly how do you use them, and what are they there for? So let me go over that right now real quick. When you have your skill set up, or you have multiple skills, by left-clicking on it and bringing them up in either the left or the right mouse button, hovering your mouse over it, and then pressing an F key over the corresponding icon that you have, can assign an F key. So let's say I wanted to assign F3 to Embracing Flames. I will press F3, and as you can see, F3 is on the screen. Let's say I wanted to do Lightning Strike as F1, and then Strike as F5. Now I can go over here, and I can assign it on the left side as well. And let's say I wanted to do F6 on that one, F7 on that, and I think it only goes up to F8. So let's do F8 there. Now, by pressing the F key, I can actually bring up the specific skills that I want. As you can see, that's really cool. So between Tab and the F keys, it's really cool. You actually have a fully controlled character that you can use when you're doing this. And the final keys that I'm going to talk to you about is Katarina. And there are specific shortcut keys you can use for her. Obviously, pressing O opens her inventory. However, if you look up in the corner here, there are you can set the melee, ranged, and ghost form. And I believe the default key on that is X. So by pressing X, you can swap between the different stances she has. So you don't actually have to go in, open her up, and then go to her behavior and pick her up. So that concludes the keybinds. I just wanted to give you a couple cool things to show you about that, so you can make playing even easier for yourself now. And that's about it for the keybinds. Perks are the most important part of a character's build, which is why the developer should have gone over this with players in great detail, because your character's build is determined by the perks you pick and not the skills or abilities. Let me explain. Perks cannot be reset. Once you pick a perk, it's permanent. Skills and ability points can actually be reset. So putting this into perspective, if you choose a perk that boosts ice damage on your character, you now have to coincide your skills with the perk you picked, because if you don't, your character is actually going to suffer a lower DPS simply because of that reason. And this is why you have to know exactly how many perks there are for your character in order to effectively build. And this is something that the developers withheld from the players, which I don't think is right. So let me start off by explaining, if you don't understand what type of perks you can choose, how are you supposed to know what's out there in order to actually pick them? So I'm going to show you all of the perks that are in this game for every character class, and I'm going to explain to you how they work and things like that. I'm going to show you that you need two different websites to understand how all the perks, what all the perks are, and what to do to unlock them. The reason why you need two websites is because one website only lists the hunter perks, while the other website lists all the perks for all of the classes, but doesn't explain how to unlock them. So you kind of need two websites to do this. So let me bring up the first website here. The first website is called orcs.com. The second website is called gamebanshee.com. And I put the links to both websites in the video description. Now, using the Windows Snap feature, I'll show you why you need both websites to understand all the perks. The orcs.com only lists the hunter perks, while the gamebanshee website lists the hunter, the thaumaturge, and the arcane mechanic perks. While both websites actually tell you what the perk does, the gamebanshee website doesn't actually explain how to unlock some of the perks, such as the case with marksman. If you read marksman, sure, it says what it does. However, if you read how to unlock it, it only says spending 30 points on a cult hunter plus some other requirement. What does that even mean? You'll never be able to understand that. That's where the orcs.com website comes in. If you actually look in marksman on the orcs.com website, it tells you how to unlock it. It literally says, you know, you need 50 points in dexterity plus this setup. And it's very precise. So as you can see, this is something you probably would never guess at, and you wouldn't be able to know it just from the gamebanshee website. Now, going back to the orcs.com website, I'm going to close the gamebanshee and only focus on the hunter perks, and I'll explain to you why the perks are so important to your character build more in depth, as well as go over how the perk system works, how to know what types of perks you should choose, and which are going to be more beneficial to you, and which ones you should completely avoid. So let me open that right now. The most important thing to remember when choosing perks for your character is, even though you have 10 perks to pick from, there are 4 specific perks you need on any build you make, regardless of the class. And the first one is destructive. Destructive does plus 50% critical hit damage. The next one is perfect aim. Perfect aim does plus 5% critical hit chance. The next one is Slayer, which does plus 10% damage. And the final perk you want on your character is Veteran Hunter. And Veteran Hunter does, it gives 3 ability points, 2 skill points, and it allows you to equip items 1 level higher than you currently are. For example, if you're level 25, you can equip level 26 items. Now, without those 4 perks, your character's damage ratio is going to suffer significantly. So remember, even though there are 10 perks to choose from, those 4 specific perks must be on every build to get your character to be the most effective it can be. So in reality, once you put those 4 perks on your character, you really only have 6 left to choose from, and you really need to be very careful about the perks you pick. So now I'm going to go over how to determine whether a perk is actually good or not, and perks you actually want to completely avoid, and as well as how to read the perks. And I don't mean what the perk says. I mean how the perk actually interacts with the game. Because the more you understand how the perk system works, the more effective you're going to be able to select the perks that you need for your specific character. The first thing I'm going to tell you is be very careful when dealing with the name of a perk. Never assume a perk is for a specific build or does something specific just because of its name. Always open up the perks and read what they do. That way you can make an accurate determination if that perk is right for your build. And using Gunslinger as an example, here is what I'm talking about. Let's say I was building a melee character and I came to this page and I'm looking for perks for a melee character and I saw Gunslinger. Because of the name, most people might skip over that because it has the word gun in the title, which means it goes for ranged. However, if you actually open it up and read it, this is what it says. You will find it actually does plus 7% attack speed. It doesn't say it does 7% attack speed for ranged. It says it gives plus 7% attack speed. So you actually want to put that on a melee character so you can actually attack faster. So again, it's very important to never assume a perk does something just because of its name. Always open it up and read what it does. Now here's some basic guidelines when selecting perks. This is not telling you what perks to pick. This is showing you a system that's going to allow you to pick the best perks that are going to be the most effective for your character's build. Number 1. Perks that require a specific situation or condition to be met in order to become active are usually best to avoid, such as the case with Berserker. Here we see Berserker gives plus 10% damage while at max rage. The problem with this perk and why it's so restrictive is it constantly needs you to be at max rage in order to get this bonus. As soon as you spend any rage, this perk becomes useless. So again, perks that require a specific condition or situation to be met in order to be effective or active is usually best to avoid. Number 2. With the exception of Perfect Aim, which gives the bonus plus 5% critical hit chance, any perk that you can get the bonus from by other means, such as enchanting your equipment or putting essences into your items, is best to avoid. And use Agile as an example, I'll show you what I'm talking about. As you can see, Agile gives plus 5 dexterity and plus 5% dodge value. However, both of those bonuses can be obtained by enchanting your items or putting essences into your equipment, and the bonuses you can get from enchanting and putting essences in are 10 times higher than what you can get from this one perk. So again, it's best to avoid any perk that you can get the bonus from by other means. Now, I'm not going to show you all of the perks like that because that would defeat the purpose of this tutorial. You yourself have to open all of these up and make the determination for yourself on what's best for your character's build. This way, you get used to the perks, how to read them, and what's best. Because the more you understand, and the more you research, and the more you look at this stuff, the better off you are going to be. Number 3. What to do with multiple perks that give the same bonus, or close to the same bonus, such as the case with these 3 perks. Teacher, Mentor, and Master. Now taking a look at Teacher, you see that Teacher gives a bonus of 3 additional skill points. And now taking a look at Mentor, you see that Mentor gives the same exact bonus of 3 additional skill points. And finally, taking a look at Master, you see that Master gives a bonus of 5 additional skill points. So when it comes down to a situation like this, there's a few things that you have to take into consideration. Sure, you can pick those perks because 11 additional skill points is great. However, you have to factor in that you only have 10 perks. And if you've been following this guide and using the guidelines I have given you, you'll remember that 4 of those perks are needed for all your characters' builds, so that only leaves 6 perks available. And if you choose Master, Mentor, and Teacher, now you've chosen an additional 3, only leaving you 3 perks. Now again, play however you want, but this guideline is giving you the best perks for your character's build to make your character the most effective. So in this case, what I would actually do, I would choose Master. And the reason why I would choose Master is because Master gives you 5 additional skill points rather than just 3. And you're only using 1 perk slot instead of 3. And again, I want to stress that you can pick any perks you want. But just remember, the more perks you pick that aren't going to be beneficial to your character, even though it would appear to be, the less effective your character is going to be. So again, you have to really think about the perks you're choosing when you're building your character. When it comes to building a character, regardless of what class you use, the principle for determining how to build your character is exactly the same whether you use a hunter, a thaumaturge, or an arcane mechanic. But since the hunter has the most complex setup of all the builds, I'll be using a melee hunter to explain how the skills and abilities work in conjunction with each other and how they interact with the game, because if you understand the hunter, you will definitely be able to understand the thaumaturge and the arcane mechanic. You just take the same principles I'm showing you in this section and apply it to either of the other 2 builds. So, starting with Lightning Strike in the Mystic Warrior tab, if you read what Lightning Strike does, down the bottom here, it says hits the target and three more enemies for X amount of lightning damage, which is a percentage of the spell power. But I'm going to concentrate on it hits the target and 3 more enemies. So Lightning Strike actually hits the enemies for 4 targets initially. So when you strike it once, it's going to branch out and hit 4 enemies. If you look at the power boost, as I like to call it, underneath wider arc, 1 additional target is hit by a lightning bolt. So if you actually have wider arc selected when you have Lightning Strike as a melee attack, you are actually hitting 5 targets at once. 4 for the original hit, and then 1 for wider arc. Now when you go into the power-ups, I'll be using Voltaic Web as an example on this, because if you put a rage point into Voltaic Web, you'll see that for every rage point I put in there, two additional targets are struck by lightning. So if I have base lightning strike with the power-up of Wider Arc, I'm sorry, with the power boost of Wider Arc, and as well as 1 point of rage in Voltaic Web, you will see seven targets are actually getting hit by lightning strike. Now, I move on over to Lethal Jolt, and as you can see, Lethal Jolt says the targets have a 10% chance of dying outright. So, that's worded a little confusing, so let me reword what that says so it's easier to understand. Any target that's hit by lightning strike has a 10% chance of dying. Simple as that. So, let me put this into perspective. Let's say you're surrounded by a bunch of enemies. Let's say you're surrounded by 10 enemies, and you hit an enemy and lightning strike. Lightning strike will branch out and hit 7 enemies if you have the power up as well as the power boost. Now, let's say 6 of those and 3 of those enemies that got hit fell in this 10% range. Because all the enemies are being touched by this one lightning strike, each one of them that gets hit by this is going to have a 10% chance. So if 3 of those 7 enemies fall within that 10% range, they're all going to immediately be dead. That's how lightning strike works with this. So when you hit, the reason I'm focusing on the word hit is because lightning strike is an attack. The hits are what actually matter, simply because of the equipment involved. So let me bring your attention to my equipment, and I'll explain how this works with this. Now, when I say hit, the reason why I bring that up is because of the enchantment that's both on my sword as well as my gun. You'll see it heals you by plus 4% of damage per hit. And this also says heals you by plus 4% of damage per hit. Now, even though I'm a melee character and I'm not using my gun, the bonus from that enchantment is still going to apply to the attack that I'm using for lightning strike as well as stack with this. So in reality, I'm actually getting 4% from the sword and 4% from the gun, which gives me a total of plus 8% of heals me by plus 8% of damage per hit. So if you basically go into the lightning strike again, remember, I'm hitting one target at first and then it branches. So basically four targets are getting hit by that. Then you got the power boost as well as 1 point of rage. So if I hit 7 enemies, that means I'm doing a massive amount of damage to all 7 of those enemies, but that's counting per enemy hit. So it's basically hitting 7 enemies, and I'm actually gaining heals you by plus 8% of damage per enemy hit. So that's a lot of life. So I wanted to make sure you guys fully understood exactly how the skills work in conjunction when you're dealing with an attack and how things operate. Now, if I bring your attention to the Occult Hunter tab, since Lightning Strike is an elemental attack, that is why you would use the elemental damage in the secondary tab. Even though you're not ranged, and Occult Hunter deals with ranged, you're still going to wind up getting the bonus from this elemental damage on a melee attack, because if you read it, it says 30% to all elemental damage. That doesn't matter where it comes from. Again, this is like the perks. It doesn't specify anything specific. It says all elemental damage. So if I go back to the Mystic Warrior tab, I read that that is an elemental attack, so I will get the bonus from just having it in the Occult Hunter tab. Now, one thing I'm going to make very clear is that over in the ability points, you will see that I still have a pretty high body, which is 2151, even though I don't have that many points into body. And the reason for that is because of partially my equipment. But the main thing here is I chose bodybuilding, because if you take a look at it, it says when maxed out, and it says 6 of 5 because I have an item equipped on me. It's called a Wraithbone Ring. It will basically make all my skills one level higher. So going back into bodybuilding and focusing back on this, the point that I'm using here with this principle is because I still want a high enough body, and because I'm gaining life off of the attack I'm using, instead of having to put a bunch of points into body with the ability, which would detract from how much damage I'm doing off of the lightning strike, what I decided to do was I decided to take some additional skill points that I had and dump it into body so that way I could dump it into bodybuilding so that way I could raise my hit point value without lowering the damage off of my willpower. I'm hoping you're starting to see how this works and how this is pieced together. Now again, your perks also coincide with this. And again, if you take a look at the perks I have for this, as I told you, there are specific perks that you want on every build you have. And just to show you, I have it. Here we have Destructive, Perfect Aim, Slayer, and Veteran Hunter. It's exactly what I told you. However, if you take a look at the other perks I have for this, here's an example of how this build works and why I'm getting so much high, why I have such a high DPS. It's not just because of my equipment, it's also because of my perks as well. Elementalist, if you take a look at this, it gives me +5 to elemental damage. That's going to raise the percentage on both of these. Same thing with Gunslinger. Remember, I told you, never go by the name of the perk, open it up and read it, because even though I'm a melee, I'm still using Gunslinger because I want to be able to hit faster with my sword. So I'm now showing you, again, the whole thing as the perks as well as the skills and abilities pieced together on an actual character. Now, one thing I'm going to point out is, if you remember what I said about the perks, you know, what to do if you have three perks that do that give you the same bonus or close to it, and that was Teacher, Mentor, and Master. Here I have Master. I chose that 5 skill point over the other two because if I had chosen Mentor as well as Teacher, I wouldn't have been able to use some of these other ones, such as Stormblood. Look at Stormblood. It gives me +15% to lightning damage. That's my main attack. Salamandra gives me +15% to fire damage. That's my secondary attack, which is Embracing Flames. Then you add Elementalist. So technically, how this works is I'm getting a +5% damage to element. I'm getting a +5% bonus to elemental damage because of Elementalist, and then you take that +5% and you add it to both Stormblood and Salamandra. I'm actually getting a +20% bonus off of these, off of fire and electric, simply because I have those three perks. So again, this is showing you how everything works together in the game itself. Now, one thing I am going to point out is that Lightning Strike is both a melee attack as well as a spell power based attack. So people don't, again, you have to remember, Lightning Strike's both spell power and melee. So back to the perks, if you take a look, it's actually going to give me a plus damage, not just to Embracing Flames. It's not just giving me the 5% damage to Embracing Flames, but it's also giving it to me to the Lightning Strike, because Lightning Strike, even though it's a melee attack, it's still a spell-based attack, which gives it elemental damage. So therefore, Elementalist isn't just boosting my Embracing Flames, it's also actually giving me a boost to Lightning Strike on top of that. So I just wanted to go over that with you. And one final thing I want to explain is that if you take a look at Magical Hunter, Magical Hunter gives a bonus to not only melee damage, but spell power as well. So how this actually works with Magical Hunter, how Magical Hunter actually works with this particular build, is that I'm actually getting a 20% boost to Lightning Strike alone. And this particular skill, I'm sorry, this particular perk, a Magical Hunter, is giving me also a +10% boost on Embracing Flames, because it gives me the spell power boost as well. However, it's giving me a 20% boost just to Lightning Strike alone. So as you can see, this is why it's really important to understand your perks, how the skills and abilities work inside the game itself and everything else. Now, the next section I'm going to go over is the tricks and the auras. When it comes to explaining tricks and auras, I'll be using the same melee build I just showed you as with the skills. That way you can actually see this information being put on an actual character that I use in the game. Now, I'll be explaining the tricks first and then the aura second. And there's one base principle that I'm going to apply here that I also used when I was explaining perks. And that is, any trick or aura that requires a specific condition to be set up or a specific situation to be met, you want to avoid. Now again, you can choose whatever you wish. These are just as the best guidelines to use when you're building this so you understand how to get the character to be the most effective you can be. So, Starting with Last Stand, you will see that Last Stand pretty much is a staple trick you want on pretty much almost every single Hunter build. There are Hunter builds that you just, it's really pointless to use this on, but for the most part, pretty much every Hunter build you use is going to use this. Now, when it comes to Last Stand, the reason Last Stand is so crucial is because it increases everybody's critical damage as well as critical hit chance. Now, a lot of people avoid this once they have a high enough critical damage because critical damage is maxed out at 400%. But if you actually do a test with this, you will see, even though this is up as high, it's up as high as it can go. Again, I have it at 9 of 8 because of my Wraithbone Ring. I actually did a test in this, and if you lower the Last Stand, your damage will not be as high when you activate it, even though you are actually at max critical damage and max critical chance. This still will boost this beyond what is on the screen. So I just wanted to make you aware of that. Now, when it comes to the build and your equipment and things like that, this is where you got to pay attention to because you don't want to overuse skill points. Such as the case, you may notice I only have 1 point in arcane healing. And the reason why is because when I have my entire character set up the way I do, I'm going to show you how much health I'm actually gaining for myself and everybody else when I use this. You will see it heals players for over almost 6,000 health. And literally, there's almost no player in this game that has that. If you do, you have a very low DPH. Now, you may notice that on a lot of my builds, if you ask me in the game, if you see me, I almost never have Ghostly Mirage picked off. I either use Arcane Healing and or Last Stand, or sometimes I don't even use Arcane Healing. It's just because of the way the character is built. But the point here is that I find, honestly, using Ghostly Mirage for a defensive character such as the Arcane Mechanic, because the Arcane Mechanic, if you actually lay him out and look at all his skills, he's all defensive. A lot of people have a problem playing him because they try to force attack with him, and he's not. If you read his skills and look at the layout of it, he's all defensive. So when you have a defensive character like that, you would absolutely need something additional for Ghostly Mirage. So in that case, what I would do is the Arcane Mechanic doesn't have Last Stand. However, it does have Arcane Healing and Ghostly Mirage. So in that case, if you actually look on my Arcane Mechanic, I actually have Ghostly Mirage set up and not Last and Arcane Healing, simply because my defensive character needs more things to attack with. So Katarina is basically giving me a boost off of that. I honestly find all of these skills pointless. None of my characters use any of these things, and I am focusing strictly on damage prevention. I honestly think, Sphere of Timelessness, because I'm constantly killing things so fast and moving, anybody that activates it when I'm in the game, it renders it useless almost immediately, because when you move, it whittles it down. It's really something that you want to only use when you're standing still, but since I'm killing things so fast, I don't stand still long enough to use that. So I just want you to, again, be aware. Please use whatever you want, but the guidelines I'm using, I'm telling you for a reason. Now I'm going to go over to the auras. Now, which bizarre, people may find this bizarre, but I don't actually have a secondary aura, and the reason why is because I don't need one. The only thing I'm using off of this is Hunter's Rejuvenation, because my melee attack doesn't actually use that much mana. I use 42 mana per attack, simple as that. And I actually have a lot of mana, so I'm not going to run out of mana anytime soon. Besides, I also have mana potions if I need them. Now, when you're dealing with things like Hunter's Rejuvenation, it gains me health per hit. And remember, I stressed about per hit with the skills. I'm gaining plus 15.8 hit points per hit. And again, my Wraithbone Ring is jacking up the level above normal, so I'm also getting the bonus for that. So if you count, my equipment heals you by 4% of damage per hit, and then you add this in on top of that, that is a lot of health gain. So I'm not using mana really, so I don't need to do anything else. The cooldown ratio, I'm not really using any tricks, because if you actually take a look at the cooldown, it's cooldown for all tricks, not auras or anything else or potions. But since I'm gaining all this health, I don't really need anything else, and I can actually not use those. I don't have to waste any additional points in here, which is basically how I got a higher bodybuilding. I tested this out and things like that. So as you can see, I'm substituting one thing in skill and aura for another without diminishing how much damage I'm actually doing. Now the next section I'm going to go over is Katarina. Now when it comes to Katarina, she's a little tricky because you can only max out three of her skills and you have a choice between general skills and blue blood skills. Now basically, you will never find me using anything but the general skills, meaning I don't use her blue blood skills except on my arcane mechanic. Because if you remember what I said about my arcane mechanic, I actually need another helper. So upon my arcane mechanics, if I decide to use summons on my arcane mechanic, I also have Katarina, which also counts as a summon, in which case I would use her as ranged assisting, and I would put a lot of her point, I would put all her points in dexterity. But on this particular build, and almost all of my builds, I basically have Katarina set up to boost me. So I'm going to go over a couple of base things that you want with her, so it's going to help you to be the most effective. Now, for this particular build, since I'm using Lightning Strike and Embracing Flames, what I've done, if you take a look down here, I've maxed out Arcane Awakening for obvious reasons. It's going to increase Van Helsing's spell power. So yes, I'm going to have that when it comes to anything spell-based. Next, because my I'm attacking, I want a higher attack speed, so I'm going to max out also Spectral Boon. It increases my attack speed by 11.5%. Next is Empower and Presence, which is just increasing the damage by 12.5%. Now, that doesn't seem like a lot, but if you actually take a look at my DPS is ridiculous. It's almost 9,000. People say that's cheating, but it's not. As if you follow my guide, you will be able to produce the same exact result. You know, obviously you need some equipment to help you boost that, because that's a part of this. But the base skill setups and perks, you should still be able to do at least 3,000 damage with just rare equipment and things like that. So let me go back to Katarina here. Now, on a lot of my builds such as Ray of Destruction. Ray of Destruction doesn't need a faster attack speed, because what am I going to do? Pull my ray out faster? No. So in that regard, a trick to using Katarina to help you in combat is builds that do not use attack speed, what you would instead do is, because again, my Ray of Destruction, I want the damage jacked up, and I need the spell power for the damage jacked up. However, one interesting thing is Spirit Guardian. Now, when I have Katarina set, when I have her using these particular setups and skills, I have her in ghost form, because she can neither attack, but she can't take damage while in ghost form by the enemy's attacks. That's where Spirit Guardian comes in, because I actually max out Spirit Guardian, because what happens is the damage that I'm taking gets transferred to Katarina. She still takes damage in ghost form when you're dealing with this, because this is a direct, it's a siphon effect, so it goes through you to her. So she's not getting attacked. You're getting attacked and then transferring the damage, which is not the same thing as, which is why she still takes damage in ghost form when it comes to this specific setup. So, what you need to do is you need to keep her alive. So, in that regard, you put all of her points into body, giving her a higher hit point value so she can sustain the damage from Spirit Guardian that you transfer. Because if you take a look, I have 1 point Spirit Guardian in this. It transfers 19% of all damage. It's not just a specific damage. It's all damage. And if you actually take a look when it's maxed out, it's actually a lot of damage. So that's another reason why I don't use things like dodge, resistances, or defense. Because I'm gaining so much health, I'm transferring the damage, and I'm killing the enemies so fast because of my DPH and my DPS, I don't need those things because the enemies aren't there long enough to actually kill me. Sure, I take damage, but I'm sustaining my way to live by other means. Just like I'm substituting a higher hit point value from bodybuilding than I would if I had put it into and points into body and things like that. So, as you can see, the principles for building remain the same no matter what character class you're doing. It's just a matter of how you want to build it. You actually have to look at what you want for your character and figure out what the most effective is. Now, obviously, aside from the perks, that is why you can reset your skills and abilities. So, basically, perks are basically the last thing you want to pick because they basically staple your entire character together. So before you pick your perks, make sure you know what type of class you want to be, what type of builds, and test these skills out in the game. See which ones work best for you. Now again, Katarina is a significant impact on what happens with your character. Because again, it doesn't seem like 12.5% is a lot, but really it is. If you actually take it and write down the original number for your DPH or DPS, and then you actually open up Katarina, and then you pump all the points into it, and then write the number down, you will see there is actually a significant impact. So the main important thing here is, your build, Katarina also has to coincide with what type of build you have, because if you don't do that, your build is going to suffer tremendously. So, that's it on Katarina. And in the next section, I'll be going over equipment, enchantments, and essences. Now I'm actually going to show you why there is no one item, enchantment, or essence that's better than another for your build. I have with me two level 30 epic capes, and both of them have the exact same enchantment on them, and both of them have the exact same essence in them. What's important to note is that each one of these capes came off a specific hunter build that I have that's spell-based. One of them is for my Ray of Destruction character, and the other is for this melee character here that I told you about that uses Lightning Strike and Embracing Flames, which is spell-based. Now, the first cape came off of my Ray of Destruction character, which is a Hermes cape. As you can see, the enchantment on it is plus 10 willpower, and it has plus 16 willpower as the essence in it. Then this cape right here, the next one, is for this particular build that I have here, this melee build. It's the Tempest Cape. Again, as you can see, it has the same enchantment on it, plus 10 willpower, and it has the same exact essence in it, plus 16 willpower. If you notice, my DPS for this cape, even though it's spell-based, goes up by 1,939.04, as well as plus 1,571, plus 0.74 for the Embracing Flames. Now, if I were to equip the Hermes cape here, you will see my DPS only goes up by plus 326.01 and 28.79 DPS. Now, how the hell can this be possible? And this, again, is showing you that there is no one piece of better equipment or enchantment or essence that's better for one character or another. It depends on the build. Certain equipment, regardless of the level, is just going to work better for certain builds, even though they're set up the exact same way. The Hermes cape works better for my Ray of Destruction character. My Ray of Destruction character, if I put that on there, it goes up by almost like 1,000. It's 1,000 DPS. It's ridiculous. But as you can see, even though both of these capes are spell-based, both of them are level 30 epic capes and set up the exact same way, one of them is just better for this particular build because of how I have it set up. It's just a combination of the perks, the skills, Katarina, and everything else involved. That's just how this game works. So again, a common mistake people make, do not get it in your head that just because it's a level 30 epic cape that it's going to work better for one character than on all the characters. The equipment, enchantments, and essences all work differently depending on how you have them set up, and it depends on how your build is. Another question people frequently ask me is, what's the best equipment for my character? What's the best enchantments I can put on my character's equipment? Or what's the best essences I can put in that equipment? And the answer is, there isn't one better than the other. It all depends on your character's build and what equipment, essences, and enchantments work best for that build. People get it in their head that just because there's a level 30 epic cape that they're going to want to use that on every character, and that is completely untrue. So, I'm going to show you a couple common mistakes that people make when they're selecting equipment for their character, as well as the enchantments and essences. And I'm going to show you how the best way to determine what's best for your character build. So, I have with me two set items and an epic helmet for an arcane mechanic in my inventory. And the first mistake people make is, people think because there's a set item, that those items' stats are set for every piece of that type of equipment. For example, I have two of the same set item, and this is the Hazardous Knight helmet. Even though they're both Hazardous Knight helmets in a set, I'm going to compare the two stats to show you. One is plus 2% critical hit chance, 6 dexterity, but if you look at the other one, the bottom one actually has plus 3% critical hit chance, but only has plus 5 dexterity. There's a few other differences between the stats. So the first mistake people make is they actually don't compare the stats to one another, and they think that the set items are all the same with that particular piece of set item. The next common mistake people make is they actually try to compare an item that they get on their character to a current piece of equipment either they pick up or somebody gives them without having all the stats unlocked. For example, this is a Fire Chief helmet, and if you notice, there is a stat on this that you don't know what it is. It says inactive, and in order to unlock that, you need to have delivered 100 critical damage hits. So basically, people would actually try to compare this helmet to one they have on and say, oh no, the helmet I have on is much better than the one you gave me or the one that I found. And this is completely untrue. You cannot make an accurate determination on whether what helmet is better without unlocking the stat. So if you have stats that are not locked, there is no way you can make a comparison to say one if it's better or worse for your character. The only way to know that is to unlock the stat and actually see it and make a comparison in the game. So now that you understand all that, I'm going to teach you a very simple system that'll show you how to know what's the best enchantments to place on your items for your character's build. Now the system I'm going to show you applies to any item you want to use in the game, as well as the essences you want to place in those items. So to start, I'm going to show you, I have borrowed 7 of the same sword from people in the game for purposes of this video, that's how I got them all. And what makes this important to understand is that this sword has the same stats on all 7 copies because that's how the sword drops in the game. And the only difference on these swords that I have is the enchantment I placed on them. They all have the exact same essence in them, they all have the same exact essence costs, and they all have the same exact stats. Again, the only difference here is the enchantments on the sword. So, the reason why I have 7 different enchantments on these swords is because these are the best enchantments for this particular character's build, and the enchantments I have on them are at max value for that type of enchantment. I'll explain as I go. So first, here we have the Silver Cleaver. And as you can see, it's got plus 5% critical hit chance in it. It's got all the stats on it, 8 to all attributes, things like that. The enchantment I have on it to note is heals you by plus 4% of the damage per hit. And as you can see, the stats that it gives me. So I'm just going to equip that. Now, I'm going to move to the second sword. And as you can see, I have the same exact essence in it. Plus 5% critical hit chance, it's the exact same stats. The only difference between these two swords is the enchantment I have on it. And it just so happens that heals you by plus 4% of the damage per hit and plus 35% critical damage, which, by the way, is the maximum amount of critical damage percent you can get on any item. It winds up doing the exact same amount of damage. So in the case where I want to gain life, I would actually use the heals you by plus 4% of damage per hit because I'm not getting any additional damage out of the plus 35% critical damage. So moving to the next one, I'm going to get rid of that and put it in Katarina's inventory. So the next one here is, as you can see, I have plus 19% weapon damage as an enchantment on this. Now, as you can see, the DPS that I have is actually going to go up 194.47 over the heals you by 4% of damage per hit. Now, when I see this, I can make a determination on, do I actually want to gain life and lose 194.47 DPS, or do I want to actually lose the 4% of damage, heals you by 4% of damage per hit, lose the life gain, and actually add more DPS. So it's kind of a factor of what you actually feel like doing. Next, let's try this one. I have actually put plus 10 luck on this. Now, one thing with luck, as the enchantment it goes, people say, well, if you're already at max critical damage, why would you want luck? So let me open up the stat here and show you that luck just does not apply to gold or critical hits. It actually increases magic find percent. Because if you notice, none of my items have magic find in them. All the magic find I have is coming from the luck stat. That's it. Because if I had basically placed magic find on some of my items, I wouldn't have the highest damage ratio I have right now for this character. So, in this case, placing luck on my sword would only give me an additional plus 10 protection. In that case, I would never use this sword for that, because I would rather have the life gain or the damage. Now, one thing I'm going to point out is that I would not have known that luck would not be good for this if I did not put the enchantment on the sword and make a comparison to the ones I actually have. So, moving to the next one, I actually have plus 10 lightning damage, which is my primary attack here, the lightning strike. Now, what makes this interesting to note is my DPS goes up by plus 42.43 compared to the weapon damage. So, obviously, if I wanted DPS, I would ditch plus 10 lightning damage and go with the plus 19% weapon damage. So far, the plus 19% weapon damage is giving me the most DPS I can get for this item, for this character's build. So let me get rid of this, and let me get rid of this, because those are no longer needed for this. And I'm just going to move on to, now I go to 10, I have an enchantment of 10 willpower on this. And willpower is basically going to jack up my spell power. That is because my character is spell-based. Now, when you actually take a look at it, even though I'm not getting the highest DPS, I'm gaining 30 mana, and I'm gaining an additional plus 31 spell power. So in reality, if I were to actually take DPS or damage-wise, even though this does 194.47, that's only for the DPS. If I were to actually take this with the willpower enchantment, I'm actually getting 3 bonuses, even though I'm dropping the DPS. I'm still increasing the DPS, not as much, not by the same, but I'm getting 3 completely different bonuses from these things instead of just one huge bonus. So again, it comes up to what you actually feel like doing. And in this case, it would probably make more sense to see I would prefer to use this over this. But again, it's a preference issue. So now I'm going to move on to the final sword. Now, what's interesting about this is the 10 body I have on not only gives me a melee damage, which is what my lightning strike is, but it also will give me more hit points, because body basically increases your hit point value and how long you can survive. So now what we have is my DPS goes up, my protection goes up, but my life goes up. So now here we have 3 different swords, all with 3 completely different enchantments on them that make it go higher than the original sword that I had equipped, which heals you by plus 4% of damage per hit. But the thing here is, if I unequip that and I want to use these, sure, I'm going to get more DPS, but I'm going to wind up losing the health gain. In this case, I'm going to gain more spell power and things like that. So the issue here is, it's not about what's the best, it's about a preference and balancing it off on what you want to use. So by showing you this, this is how you test an actual item to see what's the best enchantment for your character's build. And again, I stress that this system applies to any item you want to use in the game, and it also applies to essences. If you notice, I have the same exact essence in all of them. If I wanted to test it to see what would happen if, let's say, critical damage, I would take out the plus 5% critical hit chance, and I would replace that with, you know, critical damage. So the point here is that if you're going to test, you need to test out an enchantment or an essence with an item that has the exact same enchantment or essence in it. So if I'm testing enchantments, I'm going to want the exact same essence in all of them. If I'm testing essences, I'm going to want to see the differences between the I would have to keep the enchantment the same on all of them. So I just wanted to share that with you and give you that base principle. And remember, this applies to any item in the game, and it also applies to the essence system. And the last thing you need to understand about enchanting is, you cannot enchant an item with a bonus that's already on the item itself. So I'll explain using these boots. These boots have physical resistance as a bonus on them already. So if I were to go to an enchanter, I would not be able to get a physical resistance bonus because it's already on the item. That being said, now I'm going to go into the essence system. Now I'm going to go over how the entire essence system in the game works and then show you some really helpful things you can do with it once you understand it. Now this may be slightly confusing at first, however, if you follow along with what I'm saying, you'll have absolutely no problems understanding it once you're done with this tutorial. So to start, in order to put essences in an item, the item itself has to have essence capacity in it. The essence capacity is denoted by the pink bar on the item. The higher the pink bar, the higher the essence capacity, the more essence you can put into it. If the item has no pink bar on it, that means essences cannot be put into it. So the higher the pink bar, the more essence could be put into it, so you want an item with a large pink bar. Secondly, there are three ways to get essence capacity onto an item. That is, you can use a specific essence, which will allow you to increase the essence capacity on an item that already has it, or put it in an item that actually doesn't have it in it to allow essence to be put into it. Second way is you can actually enchant an item so it has essence capacity, and in this case I happen to enchant it with plus 11 essence, or the normal way, which is the item falls like that to begin with, or drops off a monster, or rolls like that, whichever way you want to call it. Now, the reason why essence capacity is important is because of how essences themselves are calculated. So let me bring your attention to an actual essence. And in this case, using Mercurial Essence as an example, you will see that there's the name of it, which is Mercurial Essence, and right underneath that it says Magic Essence. That's the type of essence, because there's various types of essences. And underneath that, which is what I'm focusing on now, is the essence cost. Here you see this essence is a cost of 5. That means it will take up 5 of that essence capacity in an item. So let me explain. This is an essence cost of 5. And if you take a look at these boots, if I happen to put one of those essences in here, it's going to take up 5 of that 10 essence capacity, which means now the item only has 5 additional essence capacity it can use. So basically, what you do in order to understand how much an item can take in it is you take the essence capacity itself on the item, in this case 26, and then you go over to your essence and you read the cost of it, and then you deduct the cost from the essence capacity itself. So in this case, if I put 5 essence into this, I'm going to reduce 5 from 26, and that way I wind up having 21 essence capacity left. That's how it works. So obviously, the more essences you cram together, the higher the cost, the more the cost, the more the essence it's going to take up in the capacity for the item. So for example, if I put 2 of these in there, the essence that it's taken up is 10. So basically, you add the cost of the essence together, and that's how you get the number that it's going to wind up taking up for the essence capacity. And as I said, some essences have different costs than others. In this case, this essence cost is 7. So if I add 7 together with 5, it becomes 12. And if I deduct 12 from 26, you wind up with 14. So I just wanted to explain how the essences themselves work in conjunction with the essence capacity and why it's important to have a high pink bar on that. Since in a weapon, it's going to give the weapon plus 5% critical damage. If I put it in armor, it's going to give me plus 4 dodge value. And then if I put it in an accessory, it's going to be give me plus 7 mana. Now to determine, if you're not sure about what's an accessory and what's an armor or a weapon and things like that, which should be obvious, but if not, you can actually go to the laboratory, and since let's say I didn't know if boots were an accessory and armor, I would take an essence, I would look at what each one does, and then I would see the end result here. And in this case, The end result is plus 4 dodge value, so I look at the essence and I say, oh, plus 4 dodge value, that must mean boots or armor. So now I know boots or armor. It's an easy way to figure things out. Now, what I'm going to bring your attention to now is the second tab. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to remove these, and I'm going to place this Mercurial Essence into an item that actually fell like this, because I don't want to take out that essence in there to confuse you. So I'm basically doing this to make it easier. All right, so I'm going to basically, once you get the essence that you want on the item and you see it, you click Insert. Now, once it's inserted, it's actually in the item. So now what I've done is I basically place an essence into an item to give it a bonus, and in this case, plus 4 dodge value. The reason why I did that is to show you how the second tab operates. Second tab is for removing essences from items. So if I put this in here, it'll actually allow me to remove the essence I just put in there. Now I'm back to 10 there. Now, the second tab also coincides with the third tab, and I'll explain what I mean by that. Now, normally when you put an essence into an item, I'll go over what I did here already. It increases the item, it increases whatever the essence does for that item. Now, if I place a secondary one in there, you'll notice that even though I put two in there, insert it, it doesn't say plus 4 dodge value, plus 4 dodge value. It says plus 8 because they're the same essence. If I were to put a completely different essence in there and you see the result, you'll see that I get 8 dodge value plus 2 body because that's what that does. So I'm going to insert those now. Now, when I remove them, all right, I go to the tab and I remove them all. You will see that I actually now have, I originally had 10, but now I have one Mercurial Essence with an essence cost of 10. And the reason why is because I'll show you what happened when I put these in the boots, because putting two of the same essence into an item does this. It basically combines them. So as you can see, by using the third tab, which is to enhance an essence, you actually are combining essences to make another essence either stronger or make the current essence more potent than with ones you currently use. Now that you understand how the essences themselves work in conjunction with the items and how they mathematically are calculated together, let me bring your attention to the actual laboratory themselves. Now, when you open a laboratory, it has four tabs above it. And if you hover your mouse above each tab, it explains what that specific tab does. So in this case, enchanting an item. And this doesn't mean you're going to enchant it with an enchantment. This is for essences, and I don't understand why they use the word enchantment, but don't let that confuse you. But anyway, this is where you would actually insert an essence into an item. So, taking what I said before, you have an item that has 10 essence capacity, which I used with this particular essence. I put this essence in, and it increased the essence capacity. So as you can see, if I put another one into it, it's going to increase the essence capacity to 20 because it adds 10 essence capacity. It already has 10 essence capacity in it, so it's going to make it 20. But for now, I'm going to use an essence cost of 5 and put it in there. And as you notice, you'll see right below where it says Magic Boots, essence capacity 5 of 10, because that essence itself takes up 5 of that 10 spot. So, and how to determine what an essence does is if you look below the name of it and the cost and the level requirements and things like that, you'll see that if I put this essence, do I have to put this particular essence in here? No. You can combine any essence that you want into here. Now, you're not always going to get a result, but you can this tab is used to combine two different essences in there. So in this case, remember I told you to add the essence cost together. In this case, what happens is whatever essence you place on the bottom, the end is going to be resulted over here. The one that you're placing in the middle is actually going to be the one that enhances the bottom one. Now, before I actually go into this, I'm going to use, again, two of the same essences. And again, I wind up with an essence cost of 10 because 5 plus 5 is 10. Now, it doesn't just increase the essence cost. I want you to pay attention to the level requirement and the other stats on there, the weapon, the armor, and the accessory. So in this case, when you combine two of them together, you will see that it goes from plus 5% critical damage up to 10. The dodge value goes from 4 to 8, and the accessory goes from plus 7 up to plus 14. Now, it's not always going to double. It's just going to keep adding stuff together when you combine it. So if I combine another one together, or I combine these two together, now the essence cost is going to be 20. So I'm going to combine these. And as you can see, instead of having to put them into an item individually, I can do it all at once by using this tab. So let me show you to insert this essence I just created with this. It's going to use up 20 of that 26. Now, what's really important to understand is the required level for the boots themselves is level 26. But when you add an essence into an item that you've enhanced, it's going to increase the level requirement for the item itself. So in this case, it may stay the same because it's the essence is lower than the actual item itself. But let me put it in and see what happens. So keeping in mind, the item itself is level 26, and I created an essence by using four of these. Four times five is 20. That's how I made this. So it took four of these to make one 20 cost essence of this. And if I put that in there, all right, so the level requirement remains the same. Sometimes the level requirement will go up, so just be aware of that. Because if you can't all of a sudden equip it, it's like, what just happened? So I just want to clarify that that's how you combine essences and things together like that. And the final thing I'm going to point out when you're using the Enhance Essence tab is you can only combine essences of the same type. For example, here we have a corporeal essence, which is magic essence. The type is underneath the name. And you will also see that this is the material essence is also a magic essence. So in this case, you will be able to combine them and get a result. However, an epic essence or an account bound essence is not, they will not allow you to combine two different essence types, because if you look under the name of the essence of electricity, here you will see it says epic essence. And in this case, if you try to combine it with a magic essence, it's not going to let you do it. As you can see, it won't let you because it's not the same type. A magic essence and an epic essence are not the same type. Now, in the case of account bound, here you have essence of electricity, which is an epic essence. But if you actually look at this, the poison essence is nothing but a magic essence, but it's also account bound. And just so you know, you cannot combine an account bound essence with an account bound essence just because it says it's account bound, because it goes by the type. The essence of electricity is an epic essence. The poison essence is actually a magic essence, even though it's account bound. So I just wanted to clarify that. And the last tab is what's called combining essences. Now, when you combine an essence, you actually take two different essences to come up with a completely different essence. In this case, I'm going to use an essence of fortitude and a corporeal essence. So what we wind up doing is we use two different essences to create one essence. Now, this is an actual profane essence to show you that when you actually create an essence, it's going to create the essence as it normally would have if you had found it in the game. So take a look at the actual profane essence I have here highlighted now. The essence cost is 10. Its weapon, if you insert it in a weapon, it does plus 2 mana per hit. The armor does, it gives plus 25 percent item defense, then accessory plus 3 spell power. If you actually look at the result from combining an essence of fortitude and a corporeal essence, you will see that that's what that essence does. So combining essences together to make different essences, you have to experiment with. So again, one real important factor is, like when you're enhancing essences, combining the essence, you can only combine two essences of the same type. So if you try to put an epic essence in here and then combine it with a magic essence, you're not going to be able to do it. You can put them in here, but you will never get a result from it. In order to get a result from an epic essence, you actually have to create another epic essence. But what I'm going to point blank tell you is that you cannot create epic essences. I said that to trick you, because I wanted you to understand how the systems work. You cannot, again, I repeat, you cannot create an epic essence. Epic essence can only be gotten by quest rewards, or on occasion, and it's very rare, to be able to buy them. Now, you can, however, enhance an epic essence with an epic essence, but you can't create them. So I just wanted to clarify that. The only essence that is the exception to this is the capacitive essence. You can only enhance a capacitive essence with another capacitive essence. You, even though it's an epic essence, you cannot actually create a completely different epic essence inside the combine essence tab. You can do it when you're enhancing it because you're enhancing the same type, but you cannot, under any circumstances, create an epic essence. So I just wanted to clarify that. Now I'm going to show you some really cool things that you can do that will be extremely beneficial for you when you're dealing with essences. Now the highest essence cost an essence can have is 50. That is because the highest essence capacity in any item is 50. You cannot go above that. However, with some manipulation, you can actually increase an essence to do far more than it normally would have if you just left it at 50. So let me explain. Using the Enhanced Essence tab and the Mercurial Essence, I'm actually going to enhance an essence to its maximum capacity. As you can see, I'm creating these, and I'm going to now put two 10s together, which is going to give me 20. And then I'm going to put the two 20s together to get 40. Now, what I am going to point out is that the Dismantle Item tab not only removes essences from the items, it will actually also allow you to remove the items, the essences from itself when you combine them. So as you can see, I'm back to the 8 again. Now, with some manipulation, I'm going to show you that I'm going to create an essence cost at as high as I can go, which is 50. Okay. Now here we have essence cost of 40. I'm going to put an additional 5 in there. It's going to bring it to 45. And then I'm going to put the final one in there, which is 50. Now normally, people stop there because they don't realize you can actually do additional things with this. That is why I have these three essences here. This is the same exact essence, but I want you to pay attention to the critical damage. Here you have a Mercurial Essence with Essence Cost 50, which does 50% critical damage, plus 40 dodge value in the armor, and plus 70 mana in the accessory. However, if you look at the next one, I actually have it 51% critical damage, plus 41 dodge value, and accessory is going to give me 71 mana. If you look at the third one actually says now I have plus 52% critical damage, plus 41 dodge value, plus 72 mana. Now, how that's possible is very simple. What you do, and this can be pretty much, you have to experiment with this to figure out what essences it can be done with. But here's the base principle of it. If you take a look at the Mercurial Essence I have two of these at essence cost 47, which is as close to 50 as I can go without going over. So if you actually combine two essences with as close to a cost as 50 as you possibly can, you will get the end result, which will push the essence to go higher than it normally would have. In this case, 50 essence is only supposed to be able to give it plus 50% critical damage. But by using some manipulation and understanding how the system works, you can actually push the essence to go further. So you could, even though you have 50 essence cost, this particular trick that you're going to use is going to push it far higher than it normally would have. Because what would you rather have? Plus 52% critical damage, or only 50, why would you only use 50 on, why would you limit yourself? So when you, the word of warning, when you actually try to do this and you click enhance, you will see an error message. It'll say, alchemy can only get you so far due to the theoretical limitations. The result of your current experiment may be less powerful than you expected. What you do is you click yes. It overloads the essence and forces it to give a higher ratio on, so you basically are overloading the essence to give you a more powerful essence. Now, the second trick I'm going to show you is how to create an essence without actually having to use the Combine Essence tab. This trick is very interesting because of how it works. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to combine two primordial essences together to show you. I'm going to wind up with one primordial essence with an essence cost of 10. Now, the reason why I have two different essences in here is because of what I'm about to show you. Now, when you combine two essences of the same, that are exactly the same, you wind up with two combined essences. However, if you actually combine two essences with the same cost that are different, sure, you can increase the essence cost, but what winds up happening is when you go to dismantle it, watch what happens. You will see that I no longer have that vigorous essence. I actually now have more primordial essence than what I started with. So when you combine essences together that are different of this, if you combine two essences of the same cost, when you combine two different essences of the same cost together and then dismantle it, you wind up with more of the same essence you originally used to enhance. So for example, the essence on the bottom that you use here will be enhanced here. Then that's the essence you're going to wind up with more of. Now, taking consideration, what happens if you enhance an essence that has a higher essence cost than normal? This essence cost is 7. Now, in order to basically make more essences of the same type, you need the equivalency or higher. You need a cost that's the same or higher. So in this case, I need at least a 7 cost or higher in order to make a secondary vaporous essence. So let me show you what I'm talking about. Let's say I wanted to create a secondary vaporous essence. I would put it there, and then I would take an essence that is either higher or equal to or higher than the cost of that, which is 7. So in this case, I'm going to create one that 10 cost, and 10 is higher than 7. So what winds up happening is I will now have 7 plus 10. They add some multiplication together, really bizarre here, because I know I said you add the essence cost, but when you're dealing with this, this is a different situation. This is why I'm showing you this, because it's a little confusing. However, what I'm going to wind up doing is enhancing those. Now, what happens when you dismantle it? When you dismantle it, because its essence cost is 19, there's going to be two vaporous essences plus one primordial essence. So I'm going to wind up with two primordial essences and two vaporous essence. Tricked you. I wanted to see if you were actually paying attention. The reason why you didn't wind up with a secondary primordial essence is because once you combine two essences together in the Enhance Essence tab, if they are different essences, the original one is never to be seen again. And the reason I did that was to show you, even though I said it, and you probably believed it, if you remember what I did with the vigorous essence completely disappeared. It no longer existed. So I wanted to show you that the principle was exactly the same, and you actually have to experiment with it. Don't read what anybody says. Actually go in the game and do it. Don't listen to what anybody says unless you see it. And that's why I explained to you, you can't go by assumptions. I did this on purpose to show you why assumptions are so... You can't follow assumptions in this game. So let me also show you what happened here. What's interesting about this is when I combined those essences together, you'll notice that the normal essence cost of a vaporous essence is 7. However, because of the combination I did, this essence cost is now 12. And if you actually take a look at what the bonuses do, I have an essence cost of 12, but it gives the armor plus 3 dexterity, the accessory plus 3 dexterity, instead of just 2 dexterity apiece. So basically what you can do is you can increase the essence cost itself on one essence, so you're not dealing with multiple essences, and when you increase the cost on it, you increase what the essence does. So the reason you would do this, I know that's confusing, so let me explain the reason you would do this. There are essences I've actually created with an essence cost of 8 that actually jacks up the bonus by 1 point. So for example, I've actually created a vaporous essence that was an essence cost of 8 that basically made my armor and accessory and the dexterity of it go up by 3. So now what happens is I have an essence cost of 8 instead of 7, giving me an actual additional bonus than it normally would have given. So basically I'm manipulating the essence cost to give me a higher result than normal just as I overloaded the essence. So I just wanted to show you a couple tricks and tactics that you can use to get the most effectiveness out that you can out of the essences when you put them into the equipment. Now, I do want to specify that both of these tricks I showed you can also be done with the Epic essences as well. And once you get the essences maxed out, this is another reason why my damage is so high, because if you take a look at all the essences I have in my equipment, there's 16 willpower, which normally the willpower for that essence would only be 15 or 14. This is spell power. Spell power usually only goes up to 15. By overloading the essences, I'm actually enhancing how much damage my character does simply because I overloaded the essences. And I would rather, again, use an essence that has a higher output than normal than I would if I did a just a normal average everyday run-of-the-mill essence. So I just wanted to clarify and show you how the entire essence system works so you can manipulate it to get the most effective character you can possibly get. Well, that's all there is to this tutorial, and I thank you so much for watching, and I hope you enjoy the game, and I hope to see people playing much better and not being as confused by everything. This is NPC for YouTube, signing off, saying have a great day or night wherever you are.
Sediment, groundbreak, poetical veteran. Let us connect within the head of an alien. Severable pannequin on a bed of an ambulance. Medical bandage and ambient sounds. Ambient manic and stiff. I got NY advantages. Red bull wings on cloud nine, shadow six. Lights might glow. All you see is tri-nitro. So you lean bang. Parting class, modern math. Master lost the locks, but still owns the key to craft. Artist fact, grab a map, dig it artifact. Nunchuck the sun and then raise a solid facts. Questions that are hard to ask. The answers I romance with a laugh from the lack of paragraph. Yeah. Again. Well, here we go again. Yeah. Well, here we go again. Yeah. Well, here we go again. Yeah. Again. Well, here we go again. Sight blinder, light finder. Genius star eye shining with the right hooks for my binder. Skype rhyme, rock a groove from the living room. While I find something comfortable to slip into. Like a beat coma, heat toast the record. Turn a beat over. Word curb, street soldier. Sweet Cobra Kai, cheat culture. SPO to the K online Ebola. He's older, bigger. B5 full foam. So the fees five times your dose, son. Yeah. Again. Well, here we go again. Yeah. Well, here we go again. Yeah. Well, here we go again. Yeah. Damn. Your boy's got heart. Your planet has the stethoscope, the chest to know. It seldom requests the spokes, you'll never know. Don't settle for less than dope. I'm not trying to provoke, but on a sober note, well, let's take a shot. Comatose, Mr. Overdose, hope we don't make it stop. It's a roller coaster, right on. Baton, I'm never running in place. I'm passive in songs. Bass. Head skills. Freestyle treadmill. Cardio to audio. Till cardiacs in. Custody's arms. Beats, I meet aura. Custom to harm. I lost the gloves and I knuckle the song. And so them gone. If you think that it ain't dope, you're dead wrong. Yeah. Again. Well, here we go again. Yeah. Well, here we go again. Yeah. Well, here we go again. Yeah. Again. Well, here we go again. Yeah. Again. Well, here we go again. Yeah.